Good afternoon, everyone. Father Brett here. It's Thursday, so an opportunity for us to look at the readings for this coming Sunday, the 32nd Sunday of Ordinary Time, Year A. The year is rapidly drawing to a close now, and Advent is around the corner. Advent is the start of a new liturgical year. As a liturgical year draws to a close, there is always a sense of hectic rush, busyness in our personal lives, certainly here in South Africa, where it is the end of our academic year as well. But that sense of rush and anticipation of something new is always reflected in our readings at this time as well. And there is an expectation of the consummation, the end of the world, where the Lord will return to bring everything to completion. And that sort of theme, that sort of sense, is also present in our readings for this 32nd Sunday of the year. Our first reading is taken from the Book of Wisdom, Chapter 6, verses 12 to 16. Our response to the reading is Psalm 63. Our second reading is taken from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. And the gospel extract is from St. Matthew's gospel, of course. We're still in year A at this time. Chapter 25, verses 1 to 13. Surprisingly, there seems to be a clearer link between the second reading this week and the gospel. So often we see a clear link between the gospel and the first reading, don't we? But this week it seems more obvious, the connection between the second reading and the gospel. The gospel is the story of the virgins, the five foolish virgins and the five wise virgins. A first glance, a first reading of this story sort of leads one to have a number of questions, I think, anyway. For example, the very first thing that grabs you, what shop is open at midnight to sell oil? Certainly around here, around the parish, there are very few shops that I could go to at midnight to find oil of any sort. Would that have been an option for them? Why didn't they just take what they had and risk it, give it a go? Maybe they would have gotten into the wedding banquet. Perhaps they would have got in with the little oil they had before the doors were shut. Why didn't they just try? The other thing that immediately jumps out for me is that the bridegroom, when he comes, is rather harsh and angry, isn't he? And he says to them, "Stay awake." Everybody went to sleep, including the five wise virgins, didn't they? Everybody went to sleep. So the wise virgins sort of are given the, we sort of have the sense that they were clever and they, you know, they were did everything that they should have done. Well, no, they also went to sleep. And related to this angry bridegroom, he was late. It wasn't their fault. And yet he's angry with everybody, isn't he? He's most grumpy. "Truly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." I don't know if I would want to go off with him. I don't know if I'd want to go to a party with such a grumpy person who accuses me of faults and failings, and yet he himself is late. So that's the sort of sense we get straight away from this parable, well, I get anyway, if we look at this section of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24 and 25, there are in fact three parables, three stories of the delay in the return of Jesus. Remember, the early church had the expectation that Jesus was coming soon. And that's picked up in the second reading, the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. He's writing to them about this delayed return of the Messiah. Remember, Matthew is situating this story of Jesus in his community even later. So this impatience with the return of Jesus is even more magnified, because Matthew's writing later than Paul, and Jesus still has not returned. And many in the community were getting really frustrated and concerned about this delay. And some even most probably had wandered off, saying, well, he's not coming back. Why are we wasting our time? And so in Matthew's Gospel, in these two chapters, there are three stories about this delay and trying to emphasize the importance of being watchful and alert and vigilant, because he is coming back. The bridegroom clearly is Jesus, the Lord returning. The five virgins represents, the five foolish virgins represents Israel, and the five wise, making up the ten, represent those in the church who have waited for the Messiah. And so this gospel parable is taken by St. Matthew to emphasize the importance of waiting. That yes, it is uncertain when he will come, and perhaps he will come at a time we don't know and don't expect, but he will come, and he needs to find us ready and prepared. If we go to the second reading, the letter to the Thessalonians, we have that sense. There are three important points that St. Paul makes to the Thessalonians. The first is that Jesus is coming, and we can trust his return because of his resurrection. He promised he would rise from the dead. He did. He has promised he will return, so he will return. Those who remain faithful to the promise of Jesus are those who are Christians. Pagans do not believe in the resurrection. Christians believe in the resurrection, and so can trust the promise that Jesus will return. The second truth is that for St. Paul, this resurrection of Christ means that we all will be resurrected. If Jesus has risen from the dead, those of us who have been baptized into Jesus will also be risen from the dead. The third point St. Paul makes here is really important for the community getting a little bit frustrated that he's not returning, is that he will come back, and those that have died and those that are still alive, there will be no difference, because people were hoping he would return all the Christians were still alive, but now Christians are starting to die and he still hasn't come back. So what about them? And St. Paul makes it clear that there is no distinction between those who have died and those who are alive when he comes. They will be treated accordingly. And so that's very important for that early community. And it is for us as we still today await the return of the Messiah. And so those two readings, the second reading and the gospel, link nicely together, and they give us a sense of courage and hope to persevere. We too wait with joyful hope, don't we, for the return of Jesus. And sometimes we may get disheartened, and sometimes we may wish to give up because we don't see our lives making any difference, the faith making any difference. In fact, we seem to be becoming more and more irrelevant as a community. And so these readings are meant to give us hope and courage to persevere. To persevere doing what? The mission of the church, going out and telling others of Jesus. And so this delay gives us an opportunity to be faithful to our mission, to go out and to bring others to a knowledge of Jesus. The first reading is taken from the book of Wisdom. Wisdom for the people of Jesus' time and Jesus' location, this Middle East area of the world. Wisdom was highly, highly sought of. It was better to be wise than to be wealthy or physically strong. And to go and in search of wisdom was truly a noble undertaking, something that most people would try to do rather than to seek fame and fortune. This reading was most probably written about in the first century before Christ. And wisdom is sort of the sense of living well, the art of a good life. And so all people would want to have a good life, and so all people would go in search of wisdom. But wisdom, the writer says, is to be found. Wisdom waits to be found. It wants to be found. And in fact, the author personifies wisdom as a woman, maybe a young woman, hey? Lady Wisdom. And the author gives a sense that we should be in love with this woman, that we love wisdom, so that we search for her who wants to be found. And perhaps that does link in to our other two readings. We need to be wise and alert to recognize God in our world, to recognize God coming to us each and every moment of our day, to live our lives wisely and well, so that when He does come, we are prepared. We are open to receiving Him. So there's some thoughts for this coming Sunday. I hope that you're keeping safe and well, and we look forward to having you with us at the celebration of Eucharist this Sunday. Take care, God bless, bye-bye everyone.